We have a sort of unexpected happy moment. We have a, before the presentation begins by the community, there's a very involved story that I'm not going to go into, that Holly Schaffer has painted the portrait of the first president of the university. And today, she would like to formally present it to Ken, who will accept it under the Bill Hybrid. So, two of them.
So this is Father Ellen. I am honored for the Vader Library to receive it, and I look forward to looking for it.
Well, on behalf of the library, I want to thank you for this gift and for sharing your talent with us, and we'll be pleased to hang it and look at it daily. So, thank you, Mom.
That's right.
And with that, we have Father Keneally. This is a two-part presentation today and then next Thursday. So we'll get as far as we get today and we'll continue next week. Thank you. And thank you for coming.
Good to have you here today, and if you attended my presentation in the spring, I talked a lot about the buildings, Xavier College before that. And today I'd like to talk a little bit more about people, and we'll build it around the presidents, the 34 Jesuit presidents. So why don't we get started tomorrow at the first one? As far as you recognize this gentleman, this is Father John Anthony Ellett. Father Ellett was born in Belgium, French-speaking, came to the United States very young, joined the Society of Jesus, and he was one of the very first pioneers who traveled from White Marsh, Maryland, westward to form the Missouri province, and that's where he really spent his time, since an enemy part of that province. The next picture. This is where it all began, and actually we'll move back about 9 years so you can get the full picture. This was the school as founded in 1831. It was founded by the first bishop of Cincinnati, Fenwick. We'll talk about him in a minute. And in 1831, this was the plan. This was the school itself. It was called the Athenaeum in those days, sometimes the Literary Institute. It was a very nice brand new building. It had two stories, and there was an attic. And the school actually had boarders at the time. They lived in that attic. You can imagine how cozy that was on a June afternoon. This building over here is the first cathedral of Cincinnati. It was built in 1826 by Peter and James, and this was the bishop's residence between. So this is 1831. These over here engine houses did not belong to the college at the time. So that's what it looked like. It was on the west side of Sycamore between 6th and 7th, and this is basically where St. Xavier Church is today. Okay. And next picture. This is Bishop Fenwick, after whom this building is named. He was the first bishop of Cincinnati, native-born, educated in England, became a member of the Dominican Order, and back to the United States, and worked for a number of years out of Kentucky. And this was really not very developed at all around here. And he was a remarkable man. He really covered Kentucky, Ohio, Michigan, traveling around, celebrating Mass and administering the sacraments. In 1821, Cincinnati became a diocese, and the following year, Bishop Fenwick came here. And he founded the school in 1831. Unfortunately, the following year, Bishop Fenwick was visiting the diocese up around Cleveland. He was on his way back to Cincinnati, back towards Worcester, Ohio, and he died of cholera, right suddenly. So he died in 1832, and the next picture, this is the second bishop of Cincinnati, and later Archbishop John Baptist Purcell, born in Ireland, came to the United States. He was the rector president of Mount St. Mary's Seminary in Newark, Maryland, and eventually appointed Archbishop during 1833. In 1839, while in Rome, he asked the General Superior of the Society of Jesus if the Jesuits would take over his school, the Athenaeum. Father Othon was somewhat reluctant, but eventually said yes. And so in 1840, The school you saw earlier, that Ethenaeum, became St. Xavier College. And 8 Jesuits came from St. Louis, led by Father Ellet. It's interesting, there were 3 priests, 2 scholastics, seminarians, and 3 laborers. Very important. They did all the work. But this is a very fine man. He was bishop for 50 years and a good friend of the Society of Jesus. Take the next picture. This is an interesting one if you're a Cincinnati. In 1845, the Jesuits decided that the school, being downtown, had to have a little place out in the country where they could go on Thursdays just to get away. So they purchased this from Bishop Purcell, and this was called the Purcell Mansion. And let me give you a slide here. This was in Walnut Hills, overlooking the Ohio River. So down here is the west end of Cincinnati, the Ohio River, and this building, beautiful building, looked right out onto the Ohio River, and Kentucky was loaded. To get there, you had to go up what is now Gilbert Avenue, go up Mitchell, or McMillan, over McMillan to Ingleside, and then down to the brow of the hill. And that's where it was. And so it was right at the brow of the hill, and the Jesuits owned that for about 30 years, and it was really a getaway place in the country. Of course, now it's more than hills, it's anything but country. Next picture. This is the second president, Father John Watts, also a Belgian. He actually belonged to the Maryland province of the society, so he stayed only 1 year to kind of bridge the gap, so to say. But during his time, the school itself began to suffer from the problem of cholera. It was very, very serious. Most every year the cholera would come back. Of course, he didn't know what cholera was. Now we know it's a bacterial infection that comes from contaminated water. They didn't know that. And we know from records that at least 3 Jesuits died of cholera in these years. One, shortly after the time of Father Watts, was a young man by the name of Julius Johnston. And Julius Johnston was prefect of studies, really the dean of the school, and they relied on him very heavily. One Thursday morning, he decided to take a group of students out to the Purcell Mansion that I showed you a moment ago, but not there for the day. He wasn't feeling too well. Took out there, spent the day out there on getting home at night. He was so sick, he went straight to bed. By Saturday, it was clear he had cholera. By Tuesday, he was dead. And it did, well, you don't even know the cause of these things. It must have been very, very difficult and very harrowing. But Father Watts had to deal with a number of those issues. Next step. This is Father John de Bleek. Now, Father John de Bleek was president only a short time, another Belgian, and very interested in philosophy. In fact, he's known more as a philosopher than as an administrator. His doctrine in philosophy was always a little suspect from time to time. In those days, you were supposed, as philosophy teachers, to stick very rigidly to the doctrine of Thomas Aquinas and the Scholasticism. Well, Father de Bleek departed occasionally and got in trouble with superiors. But it mustn't have been too severe because he went from various Jesuit colleges and taught philosophy for many years. But he made this complaint one time in a letter to Orestes Brunson's. This is Father Bixby. He says, unfortunately, due to the lack of free, independent thinking, no true philosophy was being taught in American colleges and universities. Next picture. This is Father George Carroll. Now, he's the first American. He was born in Philadelphia. Came west, entered the Missouri province, and he became president in 1851. He did several things, but the next picture will tell you, first of all, what he did. I like this picture for a lot of reasons. This shows you what the downtown campus looked like in the olden days, although it's a bit later from the period I'm discussing. This is St. Francis Xavier Church, which was built in 1860, so a little bit later. This building is the old Athenaeum that I showed you earlier. That was the school building. Right here is the building that Father Carroll built. Not very pretentious, but you can see it in there. And this final building I'm going to talk about later on at the corner was the Walter Hill building. So you have 4 buildings there. And this is the one that Father Carroll built. Father Carroll had an interesting problem, which points to a problem in the school. He, of course, was an English speaker of English, and frankly found it difficult working with all these other Jesuits who were foreigners. He got irritated with the fact they didn't know English very, very well. And I think it was probably very difficult for him as an administrator. It isn't that they didn't know languages. Those were from the continent, and they spoke a lot of languages. But he couldn't figure out from time to time whether their bad teaching was that they didn't know English or they didn't know philosophy. And there's one president from Spring Hill College writing to Mitchell on a similar topic a few years later. And he complained about one Jesuit teacher on the faculty. He said, "Father so-and-so is unintelligible in four different languages." Father Carroll stayed only a short time, and he became the first bishop. He was the first bishop of Covington, Kentucky. So he was replaced. We'll go on to the next picture, Bob. He was replaced by Father Isidore Boudreau, who was born and raised in Louisiana. And these were very troubled times. As one of the provincial superiors said, Father Boudreau's time was the darkest era in the school's history, and for various reasons. First of all, the enrollment plummeted almost overnight. I'm not quite sure why, but I suspect the students that were coming from the South suddenly no longer came, because the Civil War was coming on. Tension between the North and South, that's a guess on my part. For whatever the reason, they closed the boarding school because all the important students were gone. Secondly, it was the cholera became a problem and financial. But the fourth one, I'd like to talk about a little bit more in detail with the next picture. 53 through 56 was the worst days of the anti-Catholic sentiment due to the know-nothing nativist movement. And it affected Cincinnati in a rather harsh way. And this gentleman was very much involved. This is the Reverend Lyman Beecher. Lyman Beecher, and this is actually the father of Harriet Beecher Stowe. This is her father. He was a preacher in the Calvinist tradition, as Presbyterian, and he came west in 1853 to found a new seminary for the Presbyterians. It was called Lane Seminary, and it was very near here. If you go down Victory Parkway, turn up on Vigor, and just go through the intersection there at Martin Luther King, look beyond where the Cadillac Agency is. Mm-hmm. That's where Lane Seminary was. And that's where this man resided. He was a fiery, eloquent orator. He was deeply suspicious of Catholics, very deeply suspicious, and very worried about them. Careers was. He first of all insisted Catholics cannot be good Americans. They can't possibly. Because their loyalty is to the Pope of Rome, who was a head of state over there. Furthermore, the Catholic Church had no appreciation of basic American values, separation of church and state, freedom of religion, and so forth. And he was very worried. These Irish and German immigrants were coming into this area, many of them Catholic. There was kind of a thought in his mind that maybe the Catholic Church was trying to take over the Midwest. Anyway, whatever the problem was, he was here for 20 years. It was during that period he wrote his famous book, Plea for the West. And an honorable man, and I'm sure meant well. But obviously, there was some misunderstanding, I think, of what the issues were. But the next picture is even more enlightening. This is Archbishop Gaetano Bedini. And that's probably, if you know much about American history, or certainly religious history, this is a figure you will know. In 1853, the Pope sent Archbishop Bedini here to the United States for a very special mission. The Pope's purpose, I think, was rather clear. The church was growing here. Problems were arising everywhere. And the bishops couldn't solve them. They were writing to Rome for solutions, but the Pope was thousands of miles away and couldn't solve them. So what he did was to send a special ambassador, Archbishop Bedini, to the United States to solve what he thought one kind of problem. Unfortunately, it wasn't perceived that way. people were very suspicious. Everywhere in the United States Archbishop Medini went, there were demonstrations against him. And the worst was in Cincinnati. He came to Cincinnati in December of 1853. And we know that he stopped off at the college. He said mass for the students, he gave a lecture to the students, had dinner with the Jesuit community, and then went to the cathedral. He preached at the cathedral on Christmas Day, and that night a huge crowd, very angry people, descended on the cathedral. We don't know exactly what happened next. They probably intended a peaceful protest, but a riot broke out. And before it ended, one person had been killed, seven were seriously injured, including a policeman, and 64 people were arrested. Archbishop Medini left town a few days later. I cite all this to give you some idea of what Father Boudreau put up with through those very difficult years. And fortunately it passed, but those were very difficult years. And the plan really was to close the college because of the financial problems, the cholera, the declining enrollment, and the sentiment, anti-Catholic sentiment in the city. But the man who probably saved the school was the next one. This is Father Peter de Smet. Ignore the question mark. That is he. Probably more than anyone, he saved the school. And his story is a very interesting one. Father de Smet, let me go to the next picture. Let's go back to three of them. This is another one. Father de Smet is rather well known as a great apostle to the American Indians. He traveled extensively through the West. He was the founder of what we refer to as the Rocky Mountain Mission. And he befriended many of the Indians. He was trusted by them. He was involved in negotiating treaties between the American government and the Indians. But for a period of time, about 1855, he was treasurer of the Missouri province, to which we belonged at that time. He pleaded with Rome, don't close the school in Cincinnati. I know the financial problems, I know there's anti-Catholic problems. Don't close it, it's too important to see. We have to keep this school. And the pension problems are difficult, they borrow a lot of money, but let's see it through. So they did, and it was largely this man. But there's an interesting picture next, Mara. He's a missionary, and this American, the missionaries welcome. I thought you might just enjoy that picture. I don't know why he's in there, but that's the famous Father Peter de Smet. Next. Father Auguste Oakley, another Belgian, became president in 56 and 61. The parish and the school, that whole area was growing very rapidly. And what he realized he had to do was to build a new church. The church that I showed you earlier was too small, and that was his task. In 1860, they tore down the old church and put up a new one. Unfortunately, it was a terrible accident. As they were taking down the north wall of the church, as you look toward the church, the one on the right-hand side, the wall collapsed, and it killed 13 brothers. Most of them were Irish immigrants, members of the parish. It was a terrible blow, and Father Oakley took it very, very hard. You can imagine, had he been responsible for something, or not responsible, but involved, and it was very much of a blow to him. The next picture, this is Father John Schultz, and you can see he was president during the Civil War. Father Schultz had a sense of humor. He was from Alsace-Lorraine. He had spent most of his years working with the Indians out in Colorado. All of a sudden, he gets this letter from the provincial appointing him president rector of San Diego College. Well, he comes and says, this is truly amazing. I've worked with the Indians for many years. All of a sudden, I'm president of the college. He said, this is what you call obedience. So he came here more out of obedience. But a very difficult time, as you know, in 1862, the Confederate Army was moving on Cincinnati, captured Lexington, Kentucky, seemed to be moving north. And the school was closed by order of the city officials. Martial law was declared in Cincinnati. But the Confederate Army never really advanced into the city. And that's the time when they built Fort Mitchell, and Fort Wright and Fort Thomas across the river to defend the city. That was, and he was president during those years. Father Walter Hill, a new era comes with Father Hill. This is after the war, and one of the great men in the history of our college and our university. He came with many ideas, probably things that he had learned over the years. He was a Native American from Lebanon, Kentucky, became president in 1865. And he, now that the church was built, he wanted to build a new school. And here was his plan. Show the next one, Benjamin. This is what they called the Walter Hill Plan for the school. And it was conceived in 1865, and the first piece put in place in 1868. What he did was this. The church, of course, is now here. The Athenaeum is here, still here. The Carroll Building is still here. He put up this building right here. And he only built about a half of this. The back part of that would go up later on. But it was a major addition because it was a building well constructed and well put together. And there was a Jesuit who moved into this building just after him who described it this way. This is Father James O'Meara, and we're thankful to him because he wrote a diary. Here's what he said about the Hill Building. He said, it is a palace compared to the building the Athenaeum living in. He said, the building is heated by steam. In every room, there is a marble wash basin. And guess what? Toilets indoors. And on every floor, too. And that was the building we'll talk about the rest of it. And notice the very nice little port. Father Al and I remember well. That's the school we attended as high school students a few years ago. Next picture.
Tell them that Father Oakley, that Oakley Square is named after him.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Yes. I've heard that disputed.
And Oakley was his anglicized name.
His anglicized name.
He had a Belgian.
We'll do some research on that. I heard that too.
Well, all I know is if you go over to Oakley Square, there's a sign dedicating that,
oh, is that right?
Square to him. Because I thought it was named after Annie Oakley.
Also, and this another person I'd like to talk about a little bit more in detail. When Father Walter Hill became president in 1866, the war, of course, had just ended. Within St. Xavier Parish, there was a neighborhood of African American, of black people. Some of them were Catholic, and they approached Father Walter Hill with this question. They said, we really do not have a church here where we can worship. Is there anything you can do to solve this problem? And Father Walter Hill turned to this gentleman right here. This is the very wonderful, great Father Francis Xavier Weininger, third from the left there. Father Weininger, Francis Xavier Weininger, was Austrian by birth. He had to leave Austria at the time of the Kulturkampf and was sent by Father General to the United States, came to Cincinnati to the college. He is really famous as a preacher. Father Weininger really helped to introduce, at least in the Midwest, what were known as missions. And he would go into a parish. Remember, this part of the country was largely rural at that time. He would spend a week, perhaps with him in the prison. They would preach every night. They would have processions. They would have benediction. They would have special services for the children and sodality and so forth. It was much like a revival. And he, of course, was trilingual. He spoke German, his native language. He knew French and his English. He had some English, not 100%. But he spent many years doing that. His base of operation was St. Xavier. And he was also one of the assistants or associate pastors of the parish. But when this request for a black church came in, Father Walter Hill turned to him and said, what should we do? Well, Father Weininger did two things. First of all, he decided with the bishop's approval that there would probably have to be a special church because, frankly, black people would not be welcome, unfortunately, in other churches. So they did. They founded a church on the west side of Cincinnati for a brief period of time. But then eventually, oh, let's run to the next picture. This is an interesting picture of Father Wininger preaching or probably in the midst of a mission. We actually have this picture in our archives, the original. Next one. What Father Wininger then did was to purchase this building for St. Xavier Church. And notice it says up atop St. Anne's. That became in 1874 St. Anne's Church for the African American Catholic population. It is very near, or was very near St. Xavier Church as today. If you leave St. Xavier Church right now, go right across the street, there's an alleyway just north of that Procter & Gamble parking lot.
Yeah.
That alleyway was known as New Street. Go down that two blocks, and on the left was this church. It was actually a church, a Protestant church, that the Jesuit fathers of St. X purchased, named it after St. Anne. I don't know, I think the church was on the top floor. And then they opened a grade school on the lower level, and this Notre Dame de Namur sisters taught there. The group to which Sister Roseanne Fleming belongs, they did the teaching. This picture comes from about 1895. So this church existed for a number of years. It was subsequently moved and then turned back to the Pharisees. But that was the work of Father Wininger, among many wonderful things that he did. When this building was dinged a few years ago, Fenwick, I accept as a perfectly good name, I suggested Wininger. He's not honored around here, and he should be. So the next time we put up a building, next picture. This is Father Thomas O'Neill. He was born in Ireland, and as you can see, was president on one occasion and interim a few years later. He's interesting from a curricular point of view. The original curriculum of the school was essentially a six-year program based on the European model, the German Gymnasium, and the French Lycée. By O'Neill's time, though, the American influence was taking shape. They increased it to 7 years, and they divided the school, everybody say the same building, into what became high school and college. They were making that distinction, as American schools were. So you would have 3 years of high school, and then you would have 4 years. And the 4 years, freshmen were known as the year of humanities, the second year was poetry, the third was rhetoric, and the fourth was philosophy. You can see the great emphasis on literature. But that was the classical tradition and the classical formula based on mostly on Latin and Greek. But the issue of rising at this time, many people didn't want that. And some people were beginning to doubt whether that's really the kind of education Americans should get. So what was being introduced and what O'Neill emphasized was the commercial program. And this was designed for people who didn't want the classical, but wanted a Jesuit education, and they would go into the commercial program, which at some point was more popular than the classical. And there was a division among Jesuits as to which should be emphasized. This was the period of time when the president of Harvard, Charles Eliot, was criticizing classical education, filling up the young minds with all that classical rubbish. That was his attitude. Jesuits were torn, but O'Neill felt that we would simply have to go with the other. That's how we would really influence young men. So he was president through those years. Next. Father Leopold Bouchard, also from Belgium, he was a short here 3 years. Through his time, he did a great deal to raise the academic standards of the Belgian teachers. He had originally been a church before he was provincial of the Missouri province. Father, do you want to next one? Father Higgins, president on three different occasions, also a native of Ireland, County Carlow. And Higgins also helped a great deal to develop the school from a financial point of view. He was also very helpful to Archbishop Purcell. In the last years of Archbishop Purcell's career, he had serious financial problems with a bank that he and his brother had attempted to set up. It failed. And one of the people who really helped him to deal with that problem was Father Higgins. He was very kind and very helpful to him. Next picture. Father Rudolf Meyer, president for just 2 years. Relatively uneventful in the university's history. But Father Meyer went on to play a very significant role. He went on to Rome and became an assistant to Father General for a number of years. Very highly regarded and sent as a visitor around the world on a number of occasions on behalf of our Father General.
Father?
Yes.
I have a question. Did you say Bishop Purcell was trying to set up a bank with his brother?
Yes.
Really? Well,
yes.
Was that standard or that usual for a bishop?
No, it was not. It was not. And what occurred, he sincerely wanted to help immigrants, to give the Irish and the Germans here in Cincinnati. The idea was that he would take their money, invest it, and then aid other immigrants as they were coming. What happened, however, about 1880, there was a depression in the United States, and the bottom fell out of the stock market and everything else, and he lost practically everything he had in the bank. Well, it left many, many poor people with no resources at all. It was a very difficult time. The whole case went to the Supreme Court of the state of Ohio. And it was very, very difficult. And as a result, the last years of Archbishop Purcell were very sad. He deserved much better. No one ever questioned his integrity. No one ever questioned his honesty. But I think everyone conceded the bank was just very poorly run. It's a long story, but I think we'll have a short.
I just have one more question. So many of these terms are so short, you know, 2 years to 4 years, and they all look sort of relatively young. Like, where would they move on after Xavier?
Well, yeah.
Or is that another talk?
No. And it was very easily explained. There really was a manpower shortage through all of these years, and a particular shortage of people who could accept administrative positions. So there was a great deal of moving around. A problem would arise at Marquette. So Father Meyer might be sent up there for 2 or 3 years to get that straightened out. Mm-hmm. Or what would happen is, in Father Meyer's case, he was made provincial of the. Mm-hmm. So I think it was a manpower issue.
Okay.
Yeah. And you put people where they were needed at the moment. Now that's my surmise.
Yeah.
But I know the manpower problem was really.
It makes sense, they're all Europeans. Yeah.
That's right. And they were used to that, and that was part of, what they regarded as obedience. Mm-hmm. You went where you were needed, and these were extraordinarily generous men, and deserve a great deal of credit for what they did. Father Meyer was sent out to California in the early years of the California province, and he spent several years out there helping them to get organized, but they were just used to doing that. Great men. This one. I thought you might enjoy this. This is a picture of the faculty around the time Father Rudolf Meyer was president. You'll probably enjoy it. I think this might be he here in the middle. I'm not sure. But what's interesting about this picture is the number of Jesuits who were here at the time, more than I would have expected. Now, of course, this also includes the parish as well, and probably people who were chaplains and hospitals and so forth. But to think that none of these men took a salary. They did their work for room and board, and that's the only way the school could really survive. You couldn't have hired all those people. But that was what they came here to do. And this is, we think, about 1880. Next picture. Father Coghlan. Father Coghlan, another Irishman, for 3 years president here. And unfortunately, a tragedy occurred during his period of time. In 1882, on April the 6th, a fire started in St. Xavier Church. I've talked about this in my other talks. The fire was devastating, absolutely devastated the church. It was very extensively damaged. Next picture, tomorrow, let me show you what I mean. This is the church on fire. This was Holy Thursday of 1882. Interesting, here's the church. Here is the old Athenaeum building. They were terrified. They thought they were going to lose this as well, that the fire would spread over, which would have wiped out the school. Here's the old Carroll building. still there. And here at the corner is the relatively new Walter Hill Building. But the fire, the official cause was undetermined. That's what all the documents say, they never determined. And I think that's probably correct. I suspect what happened is that it was Holy Thursday, and those of you who remember the old liturgy, right, of Ivan II, there was no Mass on Good Friday. So on Holy Thursday, you consecrated twice the number of hosts you needed for Good Friday. Those extra hosts were put in a repository, which was elaborately decorated with flowers and candles and so forth, usually a silo. And there was special adoration all day, most of the day. I think what happened is someone forgot to put on a candle. And that was suspended. There was suspicion of arson. Some Jesuits gave that as opinion. But no official of the university ever said that. They accepted the verdict that the cause was undetermined. Next picture, Mark. This is the following day. This is what the church looked like then. These are parishioners over here, and I think this is Father Driscoll. I'm going to talk about him in just a minute. But that's what the church looked like the following day. Next picture, Mark. Here it is, the ruins of St. Xavier Church. And you can see, once again, the inside gutted, the roof taken away, the bell fell out of the tower and crashed in Sycamore Street. And also you can see the other buildings there as well. We don't have any pictures of what the campus looked like in those days, but that's a good one. Next one. This is Father Charles Driscoll, one of the heroes as far as I'm concerned. Father Driscoll was from Holland, I believe. He was a Dutch born. And he became pastor in 1849 and remained pastor to 1885. He was pastor 36 years. He was pastor when the church was built and also when that wall collapsed. He was pastor in 1882 at the time of the fire. Absolutely devastated by the fire, but did not give up. He began raising money immediately and found many generous contributors, Catholic and non-Catholic, from throughout the city. Our next picture. And among the donors is this gentleman here, Mr. Rufus King. Rufus King was an Episcopalian, and he donated in a very nice way to the renovation of the church in memory of his mother. His mother was a woman by the name of Sarah King Peter. She was a convert to Catholicism, and she spent her years working for the church in a very creative way. She was a woman of wealth, traveled through Europe very often, and a number of the religious women who came back to work in Cincinnati, Little Sisters of the Poor, for instance, she was the one who brought them there. When she died in 1887, it was one of the biggest funerals St. Xavier had had in years, and the Archbishop presided in her honor. This is her son, Rufus King. He was a lawyer here in Cincinnati, and he donated, they're still there. If you go into St. Xavier Church sometime, above the main altar, there are two stained glass windows, one of Ignatius and one of Xavier, beautiful stained glass windows. Those were his contribution to the church in memory of his mother. And a very great man, a great philanthropist in Cincinnati. Next. Father Henry Muller, this is the first alum to become the president of the school. He was born in Covington, Kentucky, and he was president only 1 year, but a very important year, which I'll show you in the next picture. Father Muller, who was incidentally the brother of the Archbishop, maybe Archbishop later on, but Archbishop Muller, after whom Muller High School was named, this was his brother. And he built the second part of the Walter Hill plant. This is Hill up front, and this section behind it was the building that Henry Muller built. And that's his work. And it was dedicated in 1885. They were very proud of it. This final wing of the building, going from the school over to the church, I'm going to talk about later on. This was put up in 1891. Notice the statue of St. Francis Xavier above the main entrance there. That statue now stands in front of St. Xavier High School over in Vinnington. And there it is. It's the original spot here. Tomorrow? Father Henry Chapman. Father Henry Chapman presided for 6 years and did several things, three in particular I'd like to point out. Father Chapman was very interested in organizing the Alumni Association, probably one of the best things the school ever did. In 1888, his second year in office, he assembled a group of alums and they organized the St. Xavier College Alumni Association. And they elected a president, set up a constitution, and they had their first big dinner, May of 1889. Next. And this young man, isn't this a handsome picture? This is a gentleman by the name of Francis Clout. This is Francis Clout. This is a picture of him in 1863 when he graduated from the college. 1860, I like that coat. Next picture of this is the same gentleman, and here he is, Francis Cloud, 1896, rather distinguished looking gentleman. He was the first president of the Alumni Association, and did a very, very fine job, and they became very active. That was in 1889. The banquet held that year had a very special guest speaker. This is the banquet. Very first dinner banquet of the Alumni Association. This is in May 1889, and the guest speaker was Cardinal Gibbons. This is Cardinal Gibbons from Baltimore. He was Irish born. He was the first American citizen to be named a cardinal. And he came to Cincinnati. That seems clear that he came to Cincinnati. According to the whole thing was written up in the paper, very great detail. It was a very fine banquet, and his speech is recorded. In the course of the speech, he alludes to the fact that he attended St. Xavier College in 1855, and has fond memories of all the people that he knew and loved there. Well, that may not be true. The fact of the matter is, my colleague Tim McKay, who's checked the records, we cannot find any mention of his being a student at any time. I also checked John Tracy Ellis's life of Cardinal Gibbons. There's no mention of Xavier College. But at any rate, it seems he did speak. I doubt he was an alumnus or he attended the school. Next picture. The second thing that Father Chapman did was to finish that building. The memorial hall that I showed you, the building that connected Mullard with the church. And it was a beautiful building, and it really, in the time that it was dedicated, 1891, it was state of the art. They had a wonderful gymnasium, which they also used as a theater. They had this wonderful chapel, which was donated to the Holder family. And they had state of the art chemistry, physics, biology. They were very proud of this building. This is the chapel in that building. And you can see it looks like it must be commencement because the young men seem to be in cap and gowns there. And this is the old mass, the altar facing the wall. And you see the servers there as well. Tomorrow, the next one. Father Alexander Burroughs, 93 through 97. Two things to be said about him. And, 1896, his third year in office, he decided, and this is in his notes, he decided to have a telephone installed in the college on a trial basis to see if it would serve any purpose. That's he wrote that out. Secondly, he also established the graduate program at the college in philosophy and theology, and the principal teacher, Father John Pullman, we'll talk about him in a minute. Next, gentlemen. Father Michael O'Connor, the first of two O'Connors that served as president of the university. He's interesting in that in 1900, he also got very, very ambitious and installed electric lights in the classrooms, or most of them. Isn't it amazing that there were no electric lights prior to that? He is also known, though, for a very interesting episode in the history of the school. In 1897, the year he became president, a very wealthy Cincinnatian by the name of Patrick Poland died. Patrick Poland had made a fortune in the produce business, grocery business, had done extremely well. Dr. Follin had two sons, John and William, who were both Jesuits. When he died in 1897, his estate was divided up, and each of the Jesuits got a fortune. Or not the Jesuit, but the province of Missouri got a fortune. Each of them inherited $60,000. Of course, in those days, quite a fortune. That did not come to them because they had a vow of poverty. But the Missouri provincial decided that the $60,000 that came to John Paul would be used to build a new house, a new building, or a novitiate in Florissant in Missouri. And the provincial decided the other $60,000, which came to William, would come back to St. Xavier College as an endowment fund for scholarships. It was really a very progressive idea. It's actually the beginning of our endowment fund, for one thing. And the idea was, as the provincial said in his letter, I would like for education at the college level, all 4 years, to be free as soon as we can make those arrangements. That was his plan. Well, it didn't happen right away because the money just didn't, the payoff wasn't quite as great as they hoped. But by 1918, the school did establish the William Poland Scholarship Fund. And the agreement was that if you came to Xavier, the college, not the high school, as a freshman and a sophomore, your junior and senior years you would charge no tuition. The Poland scholarship covered it. And it did for a period of time. And the plan was eventually to extend that. But unfortunately, the Great Depression put an end to all of that, unfortunately. And, but the fathers Poland are still honored. Next one. I think, I'm not 100% sure, but I think that this priest here is Father William Poland, the man whose inheritance came back to the college. I think that as he simply identified as Father Poland, so it could be John, but I think that this is William here. Next one. This is certainly William right here. Right here. I'm sorry, this is John. This is John for sure. This is the one who really, I guess, was quite a brilliant scholar. He was the one who really ran the graduate program in its early years. There's another picture on the tomorrow. And this is him. And this is Father John Poland. Lived into the 21st century, as I remember. But quite an honored figure in the school, and the name Poland is one that we should remember. The next one. Well, this is an interesting one. It says, in memory of Patrick, Mary, and Charles Poland, benefactors of this chapel. I think, this is a guess on the part, I think that this hung, how many of you remember, in the chapel at St. Xavier High School downtown, somewhere. I think that's the reference to benefactors of this chapel. I don't know whether that's true, but in any event, what it does prove is how generous Patrick Poland was, because he paid for that chapel or part of it. Next picture. Father Jerkes. This gets us to an interesting period in Xavier history. We're into the 21st century. Father Jerkes' time was noted for several. One is football. And I mention that because football became a very big thing at Xavier. I now believe the first football team was probably 1896. And I say that because we now have a picture of the team, which I just found rather recently. But next one tomorrow. This is the football team of 03. Just to give you some idea of what it looked like. No shoulder pads, no helmets that I can see. But the next picture, this is the football team, the championship football team of 1901. They played in the City League here in Cincinnati. They won undefeated. I don't know how many games they played. And they won the championship. And the Cincinnati Enquirer sponsored a parade downtown. And they were honored downtown with a parade. The only problem is shortly after, the schools they played objected because they're all high schools. And this was a college team. This is a little unfair. So as a result, the league was disbanded the following year. But we still have the championship of 1901. Interesting picture. Next. This is what, where the story really gets interesting. In Father Durkee's time, remember in mind, he was president in the very early years of the 21st century. The school downtown was getting too small. And the question is, what should we do? Every Jesuit school had to face this issue. But there were various things. By this time, there was a four-year high school and a four-year college downtown. It's now an eight-year program. They didn't have enough room. Secondly, the area around the old school was becoming a factory area. There were factories all over them. It was noisy and dirty. Thirdly, the traffic downtown, particularly where they were at the corner of Southern Sycamore, was very, very irritating. But maybe one of the biggest concerns was fire. In 1910, there was a terrible fire in downtown Cincinnati, and it occurred very near the school. It was to the east of the school. It was between Sycamore and Broadway, between 9th and Court. That whole city block burned out. The fire burned for 322 hours. Six factories were totally destroyed, and five others were very seriously damaged. But all those factors together, Father Durkee's and his board of trustees decided we have to move and begin to move to the suburbs. And that's what we did. And this was the first attempt. What they did in 1906 was to purchase this house, and this is also on Gilbert Avenue, at Lincoln. And Lincoln, probably if you come up river, just before you get to Martin Luther King, there's Lincoln Drive there. On the southwest corner, they purchased this house. And they opened it as a brand school. Now, I'm not quite sure what they thought they achieved by this. The numbers of students were very small, and it only operated for a couple of years. Here's another picture, and you can see the sign there, St. Xavier Branch College. This was an attempt to move to the suburbs, but it really didn't work very well, and something was clearly had to be done about it. Before we move to that, though, I'd like to talk about another distinguished figure, really, in Xavier history. And this is Father Francis Finn. Father Francis Finn spent most of his priestly career here in Cincinnati. He is best known for two things. This is the man who in 1925, participating in a contest, suggested that the Xavier athletic teams be known as the Musketeers. This is his idea, and he argued that the idea of this is one for all for one. Won the contest. Of course, he was a member of the Board of Trustees that helped him also, but that was his idea. He's also noted, though, as an author of 27 novels for juveniles, for young people. And they were immensely popular. He was a wonderful raconteur, just a wonderful storyteller. His books were translated into numerous languages, almost published by Benzinger. And that was his real claim to fame. But for many people in Cincinnati, he was much more than that. He taught regularly, but also was associate pastor of the parish. And he was very much concerned with the parish. He ran the grade school, and raised enough money so that the grade school became free. No tuition was started. It was the very first grade school in the Archdiocese to achieve that. That's the work of this man. And he was known to move around the parish constantly, carrying groceries to one place, throwing clothing for another, because these were immigrant people who were still struggling to make their way. And the story is told of often he would be walking downtown Cincinnati, someone would come up to shake hands with him, and after shaking hands, Father would find a $5 bill in his hand, that type of thing. He was much loved, and this is the man. So a couple of more interesting pictures of him. Here he is in the middle. And I love this picture. And this is Father Finn right here. And this is a Father Ryan, I think Charles Ryan. And he should not be forgotten. Father Charles Ryan, all of these people worked in the parish. This was the parish staff. Charles Ryan ran a three-day nursery for years downtown. I don't know whether he founded it or not, but it was a building right next to the church. And it was a three-day nursery. Women could bring their children there, and women in the parish would take care of them. I guess we're running out of time.
We are.
Okay.
Unfortunately.
We'll come back.